Get your water, get your mints, and let's have a seat. Come on in the room. So, hey, Philippians chapter 4 invites us to consider something. And Paul says this. He says, rejoice in the Lord always. And when I read that, y'all, like my heart was really stirred up, but also convicted. Because when Paul says rejoice in the Lord always, what Paul is saying is that there is always a time to consider rejoicing in the Lord. And so rejoice is a choice. We choose to rejoice. Just like we choose to consider all the other emotions that we will lock in on, rejoice is a choice. And so this morning, y'all, like maybe some of you are walking through a really difficult season. Maybe some of you are overwhelmed with the circumstances of life. Maybe you're fatigued. Maybe you're exhausted. Maybe you're actually in a season where you're like, oh my goodness, play that song. I'm ready to worship the Lord. Wherever we are in this room, there is one consistency that all of us are invited to do this morning, and that's rejoice. Not in our circumstances, not in what we have, not in what we can do. The Bible says, rejoice in the Lord. And so what I want to encourage us to do this morning is to consider the goodness of God. Consider the grace of God. Consider the mercies of God. Consider the salvation that the Lord has so graciously given us. Consider forgiveness. And as you think about the goodness of God and all that the Lord has done for you, rejoice in the Lord. That may look different. Somebody may want to run a lap this morning. You better run. Somebody may want to lift their hands this morning. Lift your hands. Somebody may want to shout this morning. Shout in the Lord. Whatever it is, we have an opportunity this morning to simply rejoice. Can we do that this morning? Rejoice in the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, hey, let me pray for us. And as I'm praying, I'd love for you all to stand up as we prepare our hearts to sing songs of praise to the Lord. Father, thank you so much. Thank you that we have an opportunity this morning to rejoice. God, thank you that even as we stand, Lord, God, even what this means is a corporate posture of preparing our hearts to worship. Lord, as I saw the room stand, I just felt like we're standing because the authority of God is among us. And so, Lord, we consider you this morning. God, wherever we are this morning, we have a choice to rejoice. And so, God, would you stir that up in our hearts? Would you give us the freedom and the room to do that? And God, I just pray, if there is anything happening in our hearts, in our homes, in our heads, that would hinder us from surrendering praise to you this morning, remove it, Father, we pray. Secure this body for right worship. Secure our hearts to receive what you have for us this morning. Yeah, Lord, would you just pour out your presence today? Holy Spirit of God, you are invited into the room. And not just the space that we stand in, you're invited into the room of our hearts. And so, Lord, I just pray in the name of Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would give us ears to hear, release our lips to sing, open our hearts to receive. God, you are good, and you are worthy of our praise. Let us consider that this morning. You are worthy of our praise, God. And so we praise your matchless name, Jesus. It's in Jesus Christ's name we pray, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us, come rest on us. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, hearing, I know you are moving. I'm hearing, I know you will fill me. Sing fire and wind. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Sing that again, fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Sing, Holy Spirit, you're all we want. Sing this out. The living God is with us in this room this morning. We're not singing to some far off imaginary thing in the sky. The scripture says that where two or more are gathered, here I am with you also. So he's here. So let's sing to his spirit together.
Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want.
Sing that again, Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want.
Holy Spirit, sing that again.
Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me.
By power, by your spirit, God, send your spirit, God, not by might, not by power, by your spirit, God, send your spirit, not God, not by might, not by power, by your spirit, God, send your spirit, God, not by might, not by power. Abraham, you're the God of covenant, of faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven you do just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn when you speak a word. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. situation, though the earth may pass away, your word remains the same. Your history can prove there's nothing you can't do. You're faithful and true. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn. When you speak a word, it will come to pass.
Great is your faithfulness to me. Praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. Oh, 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 your faithfulness, it never runs out. It never runs out. He's our anchor,
my anchor to the ground,
my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I'll put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. The setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. Father, thank you that you have been so good and so faithful to us, Lord. Thank you that as the song says, seasons change, but your word remains the same, and we can look back. As scripture says, we have such a great cloud of witness, such a great legacy of faith of people that we can look back to who you have done miraculous things through and who you have also just been really faithful in the small things too. God, help us to hear from you this morning. We pray this morning as a body that just even as the weather was changing this morning, that it felt significant. That it is May 20-something in Texas, and it's cold. So, Father, we come this morning with expectation, knowing that you are sovereign, that you are mighty, that you can move in big and miraculous ways, and that you are kind enough to move even in the day-to-day. Father, you are good, and help us to hear from you this morning. Amen.
Amen. All right, well, you can take a cheat, seat, not a cheat. You can take a seat, church. How's everyone doing? Good, good. Well, hey, my name is Reese. I'm the associate pastor here at Christ Freedom, and it is a joy, as always, to be with you this morning as we continue our series that we've been in for the last few weeks through the book of Philippians. And to start off our time this morning, I wanted to read a paragraph in an article I came across this last week. This is from the New York Times. It came out in February by a guy named David Brooks. And the title of the article is "The Dissenters Trying to Save Evangelicalism from Itself." It's a little bit of a mouthful, but this really struck true for me. So listen to this and let me know if you relate at all to what David Brooks writes here. He says, "Think of your 12 closest friends. These are the people you vacation with, talk about your problems with, do life with in the most intimate and meaningful ways. Now imagine if six of those people suddenly took a political or public position you found utterly vile. Now imagine learning that those six people think that your position is utterly vile. You would suddenly realize that the people you thought you knew best and cared about most had actually been total strangers all along. You would feel disoriented, disturbed, unmoored. Your life would change. This is what has happened over the past few years to millions of American Christians, especially evangelicals. So quick show of hands if you can relate to that at all, even in a small way. Okay, a good number of us. I know that I can. Over the last few years in our country, we have gone through a ton of division, right? The body of Christ in many ways has been torn apart over many different issues. And David Brooks in this article, he lists just a few, and none of these will be news to anyone here most likely, but he highlights things like differing opinions on COVID protocols, right? Whether to wear a mask or not to wear a mask. Different political differences, attitudes towards racial tensions in our country, abuse scandals in the church that if you follow the news seem to pop up every month. These are just a few of the things that he points to as causing this massive rift in the body of Christ over the last number of years. And it's not just the church as a whole, though. It's friendships. Right? Maybe it's neighbors that you used to talk to, but no longer. Right? This has even had an effect on marriages. There was a big law firm that did a study, and they reported that they had a 95% increase in inquiries about divorce over the course of the last couple of years with the pandemic. We are living through a time, and this isn't news to anyone, of extreme disunity in our country, but also in the body of Christ. And I bring this up because last Sunday, Pastor Robert took us through the end of chapter 1 in Philippians, where Paul is appealing to this little community in the city of Philippi to live a life worthy of the gospel by standing firm against external opposition, but also by standing together as one. The section that we're in is about the call to live together, to live in unity with one another for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of the advance of the kingdom of God. And so this morning, we're going to continue on that thread. And the question that I want us to wrestle with is, in this time of disunity that we are in as a culture and as a church, capital C church, how do we stand firm together? But as a local body, as friends, as neighbors, even as spouses, in a world of hostility, how do we stand as one? Last week we looked at Paul's command to stand firm, but this week we're going to talk about how we do that. That's kind of where Paul takes us in these verses. So we're in Philippians 2, verses 1 through 11. If you want to follow along, I'd encourage you to do that. Philippians 2, verses 1 through 11. And we're going to see two things in these verses. First, the urgency of unity, why it is so important, and then the practical how-to of unity. Like when the rubber meets the road, how do you practically work to be a unified people? So first, and probably most briefly, because in a lot of ways this is kind of a little bit of a recap of where we were last Sunday, but I want to look here at the urgency of unity that Paul communicates. At the end of chapter 1, Paul says, stand together, right? He says it three different ways, three different times. And then here, only a few verses later, he says it again. This is verse 1. So if there's any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. All right, so Paul here, he will not stop harping on unity. All right, he says it just a few verses before three times, then he says it here again three more times. And if you were with us earlier this year as a church, you know that we wrapped up a series through the book of Ephesians, and in that letter as well, this is a huge theme. And my just following along as a church through that book, that was probably one of my biggest takeaways, is how much time Paul spends calling the people of Christ to live together. So much so that if I'm honest, there'd be some weeks where I'd be, you know, reading ahead in anticipation of the sermon we were going to be hearing that week. And I was kind of like, Paul, we got to switch this up a little bit, right? Variety is the spice of life. Why do we keep talking about unity over and over? And then here in Philippians, here it is again, unity over and over. It is all over Paul. He says it constantly. If you've been impacted in any way by Christ, then you have to get on the same page. You got to get your act together and live unified. Why is this such a big deal for Paul? Well, I think why is because Jesus said that the defining characteristic of followers of him to the world is our unity. When he said the way that the world, a hurting and lost world, will know that you're my followers, they will know it by your love. John 13:35, by this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. The defining mark of our discipleship to Christ isn't if we have a quiet time every day at our favorite coffee shop, right? It's not if we know how to raise our hands at the right moments in a church service, although those are good things. It's not those. The one mark is our love for each other. It is our unity. It's how the mission advances. That's what's attractive. And when unity suffers, mission suffers as well. But I think that's why Paul talks about it all the time. When unity suffers, when our like-mindedness is not there, the mission of the gospel does not go forward as it should. So we have to ask ourselves, are we striving for unity? Are you putting in the hard work of living together as one in your most important relationships? A number of, probably 2 weeks ago, me and Pastor Robert really got a pretty powerful picture of this. We went around to multiple churches here in the city of Louisville, unannounced. We just took an afternoon to pop in and pray for anyone that would have time or let us pray for them. And overall, it was very encouraging just to see how God really is working and reaching different communities of people here in our city and the surrounding areas, and just how faithful ministry is going forward in our city. But we also encountered a lot of what you might call the fallout of disunity that we just kind of talked about here at the beginning. There's one church that we encountered who has been faithfully serving the city of Louisville for over 100 years, right? Longer than anyone in this room has been alive, most likely. And over the course of the last couple of years, they lost half of their people because of reasons that really shouldn't probably divide the body of Christ. We met with another pastor, very similar story, long faithful ministry in the city of Louisville. And within a moment, you could tell he just looked tired, worn down, beaten up, and he was open about it. He said, man, I'm just trying to hold on and pay the bills, right, so that my staff can remain, so that this church can keep functioning, because we've lost tons of people. And where there used to be this fervor, this is what he said, an excitement kind of out around outreach and around mission, we are back to the very basics. We are just trying to survive, and I'm exhausted. Right? It was this vivid picture of how mission suffers when the body of Christ does not hold together. And it's why I think Paul is so adamant here. Right, for the sake of the gospel, get on the same page. But then he even hints at, not just for the gospel, but even for the sake of your own joy. Right, Paul starts this prayer. He says, if you have any encouragement in Christ, make my joy complete by living together. Right, it's almost like Paul is emotionally involved with the togetherness of this church that he helped start and that he's still a part of, even from a distance, because not just mission, it's not just mission that suffers when we aren't living together, but our personal joy suffers when our closest relationships are out of whack. And so Paul says, make my joy complete. Strive to live in unity. Right, that's what we all want. Right, no one doesn't want to be a part of a community of brothers and sisters who love one another well, who serve each other's needs, who are advancing the cause of the gospel. I mean, who doesn't want that? I want that. But it takes work. Right? It requires a proactiveness. And I think for some of us, it's easy to be in a relationship when maybe it's something's off, maybe it's maybe you're miserable even in that relationship. But the thought of doing the hard work of seeking reconciliation can sometimes, for me at least, feel so overwhelming. I would rather just kind of sit in the funk and not put in that hard work. But Paul says it is worth it. Right, so for the sake of the cause of Christ, for the sake of your own personal joy, unity is urgent. And I think until we see that, we won't do the hard work that it often requires. Right, so how do we strive for it? Right, that's why it's important, but then how do we actually practically begin to move and work towards unity? That's what Paul is going to get into here in verse 3. He begins to answer this question. Look at this. Verse 3, chapter 2. Paul writes, "Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others." What is the key to unity according to Paul? In one word, it is humility. But the work of unity begins with humility. Where there is division in the body of Christ, where there's division in a friendship or in an important relationship, there is at least one or maybe both parties who are lacking in humility. Right, so what is it? Right, humility, it's a word I think we throw around a lot, especially in the church, but what does it really look like? Well, Paul begins here, I think, by first telling us what the opposite of humility is, what it is not. He says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit. All right, so let's look at each one of these before we get to the more kind of positive version of humility here. This first one, selfish ambition, the word for that, it literally means a mercenary spirit, right? And here's what a mercenary is. A mercenary is somebody who will fight for the cause of a particular army or a particular nation. They'll go to battle, but not because they actually believe in the cause itself, but just because they want to get paid. That's what a mercenary is. I will advance your cause, even though I don't personally believe in it, as long as there's something that is in it for me. It's beneficial to them. When selfish ambition, in other words, comes into contact with another person, the first question it asks is, how can I use you to get what I want? Right? How can I use you? There's always this calculating that's going on. If I do this, what then will you, you know, give to me? It's very transactional. And we're not immune from this, obviously, just because we know Jesus, right? I sense this in my heart. Hopefully you sense it in your heart too. Not that it's a good thing, but you know, self-awareness is a good thing. But even in the church, right? Hey, I'd love to lead in this ministry, right? I'd love to serve here. I would love to volunteer here, but not really because I care about this thing, but I kind of just want power. Right? Or maybe I just want a platform to let you know how wise I am or how godly I am or how well I know my Bible, whatever it is. It's entirely possible to be deeply involved in the life of the church and ministry and yet behind the scenes be doing it to advance our own personal goals. That's what this mercenary spirit of selfish ambition Paul is talking about here. Or apply it to a friendship. Right? The mark of humility in a friendship or a marriage, I would say, isn't necessarily that you serve that other person. The mark of humility in a friendship is that you serve the other person even when that other person is not returning the favor, right? When they're not serving you back. Because if you're only serving as long as the person is giving something back to you that you need, that's a business transaction. That's a mercenary relationship. It's not true humility. You're not serving them. You're serving yourself in serving them. That's the mark of humility. Right, selfish ambition says, how can I use you to get what I want? And it's the first thing that is the opposite of humility that Paul highlights here. But then Paul goes on to this other word, conceit, right? Don't just do things out of selfish ambition. Don't do anything out of conceit as well. And here's what I think conceit is. If selfish ambition is, how can I use you? Conceit approaches a relationship and says, I need you to look at me. All right, don't look over there. Keep the eyes on me, right? Look at me. It's interesting that this word for conceit here in the Greek is kenodoxia, and it's the combination of two words, doxia, which you probably know, doxology. Right? Doxia means glory, and keno means empty. So literally, conceit means glory empty. It is a person that moves into the world empty of glory. And when you hear glory, think of weightiness or significance, a sense of value. It's the person that goes into the world, into relationships, desperate to know if they are worthwhile. And so they're always saying, look at me because I need you to fill my glory empty heart, right? That is what conceit is. See, it's entirely possible for me, right, to stand up here and preach this sermon, not because I really care about the building up of this body, but because I want you to look at me. Right? It's entirely possible for me to preach this sermon so that you'll walk away and say, man, that Reese, he's really got his ducks in a row, you know? He really knows his Bible, like he's a pretty, you know, godly person. And I would be lying, and I think you would be deceiving yourself if you don't see that tendency at work in your heart, at least to some degree, right? You don't know your heart if you don't sense any of that in there. It is a battle, something that we have to work and fight against all the time. Now, the gospel, the good news, part of the good news of the gospel is that we can be freed from conceit, right? We can be freed from operating out of this, look at me, I'm desperate for affirmation, but it is a process. It doesn't happen in an instant. It is a lifelong pursuit of resting in who Jesus says that we are and what he has done for us. Now, when you think about this need to be seen, because I think sometimes we can say, you know what, that's not really me, Reese. I like to be kind of in the shadows. I'm a very quiet person. I'm very, you know, self-deprecating. But I don't think that kind of exempts you from this, because it's just as easy, I think, for conceit to take the form of an extreme kind of self-deprecation. Right? I knew a guy at another church who I'm still friends with today. I walked alongside of him during a certain season of life, and I used to call him Eeyore from like Winnie the Pooh. Not to his face. I didn't, although I thought about it. I wanted to. No, but in my head, I used to kind of think of him as this Eeyore, because he always went around with this false humility, letting everyone know how insignificant he was. Right, so he'd be kind of like, I'm nothing. I'm the Lord's servant. I'm dirt. I'm less than dirt. And if I do anything good, it's not me. I'm a worm. It's the Lord. Don't look at me. It's the Lord. Wait, don't go away. I'm still telling you how sinful I am, how lowly I am. And what he eventually had to realize is that even in the moments he was thinking he was being humble, he was just as desperate for others to look at him as the person that's kind of big and obnoxious and is doing it in a more forward way. Right? He wasn't saying, look how amazing I am, but he was saying, look at how horrible I am. Right? Look at how lowly I am. Look at how worthless I am. But in the end, he just wanted people to look at him. Those are two different sides, I think, to this vain glory that some translations use for this word conceit. So that's what humility is not. Right? Paul says, do nothing out of selfish ambition. How can I use you to really get what I want? And do nothing out of conceit, out of this glory hungry, I need affirmation, so look at me kind of a attitude. But then he goes on to say what we should do. Instead, he says, in humility, move towards others. So what is humility? Well, Paul, he doesn't really give us an exact kind of dictionary definition here of humility, but what he does do is he shows us what humility looks like when it is in action, or when it is lived out. Now look at the scripture one more time. He says, in humility, count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. See, humility, I think, is a matter of where you spend most of your time looking. A humble person isn't someone with low self-esteem. A humble person is someone with low preoccupation, right? They don't think about themselves all that much because they are busy thinking of you. C.S. Lewis describes it like this. He says, do not imagine that if you meet a really humble person, he will be what most people call humble nowadays. He will not be a sort of greasy person who is always telling you that, of course, he is nobody. Probably all you will think about him is that he seemed a cheerful, intelligent chap who took a real interest in what you said to him. He will not be thinking about humility. He will not be thinking about himself at all. And I love that description because I think personally, when I think of, okay, how can you really tell if someone is a humble person? I think one of the quickest ways, at least for me, that I feel like you get a window into someone's attitude is that whenever you are with them, whenever you're talking with them, they take a genuine interest in you. They don't spend all the time just telling you about themselves. They ask you a lot of questions. They're genuinely curious to know about your life. When you see them, it's not this, hey, look at me, Reese has arrived to the party. It's more this, look at you, right? The spotlight is on you, not only them. And not because they're trying to get something out of you, but because they just care about your life. And when they learn of a need that you have, they're also willing to take on the posture of a servant and help to meet that need as far as they have the capability to do it. Our humility, Paul says here, is a matter of where you spend your time looking. Don't just look out for yourself. Look out for the interests. Look out for the needs of other people. So in relationships, are you looking? Where do you spend most of your time looking? Is it at yourself? How am I being perceived? What are other people thinking about me? How's my hair look? What about my clothes? Are you looking out for the interest of you or also for the interest of other people? But if you're married, how often do you take the time to learn about the interests of your spouse, what they need, what they are doing? But how might our marriages change if once a month, I don't know who recommended this, but someone told me this once, and I think it's really great advice, but if once a month in your marriage, not when you're having a fight, but when everything's, you know, right with the world, you're on good terms, what if you sat down and monthly asked the question, hey, how can I serve you better? Or do you have any needs in this season of life that I can maybe be a part of meeting? Right? How can I serve you better? If we ask that in our most important relationships, even once a month, I think the level of unity that might come out of that would really surprise us and be a source of life. Now, this doesn't mean that you don't take care of yourself, right? That's not what we're saying. Paul even says, look not only to your own interest, right? So he acknowledges that we have needs. There's a place for self-care, but he kind of assumes that we're going to be pretty good at that, right? You don't have to work, at least me, I don't have to work all that hard to think about myself. It's just my default posture. I usually find a way to eat food and clothe myself and, you know, meet my basic needs. That's kind of happens. It's looking out for those needs of others that Paul says requires intentionality. So earlier this spring, I planted a bunch of tomato plants in our backyard. And y'all, I have loved these tomato plants like a newborn baby. If you've been to my house, People in my mission group know that I take a lot of pride in these tomatoes. I built a cage, a raised bed, and I built a cage over them so that no rodents or birds can get in there and, you know, mess with my tomatoes. I fertilize them. I water them. I even got a little water gauge. I stick in the soil. How moist is the soil? I don't want to be, you know, too uncomfortable here. I've really cared for these tomatoes, and there's been actually some fruit recently. There's tomatoes popping up on these plants. Green tomatoes. But a couple of days ago, earlier this week, I went out there in the morning, and about half of the tomatoes on my biggest plant had end rot that set in overnight. Oh, some of y'all know what end rot is. That's great. Basically, this dark spot at the tip of the tomato that starts from the inside and makes it inedible. They're ruined. And y'all, I was so upset. I was angry, I was frustrated, you know, like, oh my, I've spent so much time on these tomatoes. Why, God? Why me? You know, why now? And I was really emotionally frazzled. So I cut them off, and then I go to work and sit to study this passage that says, hey, don't only worry about your own interest, but also the interest of others. And I'm like, okay, God, I get it. I've been very concerned about my own interests. Is it silly for me to be upset? And I feel like the Lord said, you know what, it's okay. It's okay to be upset about the tomatoes. You've worked hard. You've put in a lot of work. It's a reasonable response to feel a little bit of frustration overnight when you come and a lot of them are ruins. But then in a very gentle way, I feel like the Lord said to me, but if the strongest emotional response that you have today is about your tomatoes, when you are living in a world with so many needs, then that's probably not a good sign. And man, that just clobbered me. Like, if there is a way that we could map my emotional resources, if we could say, okay, let's see how much emotional energy each day of the week or each day of the month Reese expends as he goes through life. If there are more emotional resources expended on tomatoes than on the needs of those that are around me, then I'm a shallow person. And I don't want to be that kind of person. And if there is a way that we could do the same for you, if we could map the emotional resources that you spend in a given month, if more of that is spent on you and your own interest than on the interest of those around you, then you don't want to be that person either. But that's the kind of person who drives wedges in community, that drives disunity. It's the kind of person who generally themselves is not all that happy. Because we were made in the image of a self-giving God, which means that our joy is wrapped up in giving our lives away more than it is in taking from other people. Where unity is lacking, humility is almost always certainly missing. So Paul says, be humble. Right, be humble. Now, the problem with that is how do you be humble, right? You can say, okay, Reese, I get it. I want to grow in humility, but how do I do that? Because for me at least, I don't know if I'm unique, but commanding a virtue, commanding humility is not something that I can do. I can't just be like, humility now, and then all of a sudden care about people. I can't just flip a switch. So how do you do it? How do we grow? Well, I think the pursuit of humility has to be mainly an indirect pursuit. But if humility is thinking of yourself less, then it is hard to grow in humility if you are always self-evaluating and feeling the pulse on how humble you are. Right? Like, am I being too self-centered? Am I being curious enough? Am I thinking about myself too much? Am I posting on TikTok too often? Right? The problem is that you're only thinking about yourself when you're doing that. Right? There's a sense in which you've become less humble by the minute that you've been listening to this sermon if you've been thinking about how humble you are. Right? The nature of it is to look away. It's why one pastor I heard said that humility is the shyest of all the virtues. It's kind of the hardest to wrangle in, which means it has to be pursued, I think, in a more roundabout way. And here's how I think we do it or begin to do it. Humility grows as we begin to look away from ourselves at something that is more impressive than ourselves. Right? Humility begins to grow the more that we can look away from us, the more I can look away from Reese at something that is greater and bigger and more glorious than me. It's why even a pretty prideful person, whenever you hear a magnificent piece of music, or you look at, you know, the Grand Canyons or the Rocky Mountains, or you look up at the, you know, the night sky when you're camping, what's a common response? People say, man, this makes me feel so small, right? I feel so insignificant before this massive big thing, right? That's the language of humility. It's an accurate view of your place in this big world. And it's why, I think, Paul doesn't just say in these verses, be humble, right? Go out there, work hard at it. No, he says, be humble. He does say that, but then he launches into a hymn about the beauty of Christ. Right? Verses 6 through 11, it's a song, right? It's a piece of art about the bigness and the beauty of our Savior. So let's look at this with these last few minutes. Starting in verse 6, Paul starts like this. He says, have this mind among yourself, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. Now when Paul says that Jesus was in the form of God, it doesn't mean that Jesus just looked like God, he had the appearance of divinity. No, the word form means that he was God. In his very nature, from eternity past, Jesus was God. He shared the same essence in every way as God the Father because he was divine. And yet, when Jesus saw our need, when he saw us under the cloud of sin and death, he didn't grasp, he didn't cling to his divine privileges that were his. He didn't let his divine rights keep him from meeting the needs of other people. That's what Paul's getting at here in these verses. Right? Jesus didn't have to save us. I don't think about that enough. You know that, right? Jesus didn't have to launch the plan of redemption that we celebrate every Sunday morning when we come and gather here. He didn't have to do that. He could have looked the other way because we were the ones that ran from him. He didn't run from us. All he gave us was his perfect love, and we said, you know what, God, I'm good. I'm going to do things my own way. And God could have looked at us and said, okay, have it your way, right? Thy will be done. I won't impede. And he would have been totally just and righteous to do that. But of course, that's not what God did. Right, he considered our needs. And then he chose to become uncomfortable. Like really uncomfortable. Right, he chose to be inconvenienced. He had the divine right to stay in the heavenlies and let us go about our rebellion, but instead, he didn't grasp for those rights and those privileges, and he came into our broken world. Aren't you thankful that Jesus didn't have the attitude towards us that so many of us in the church at large have had over the last few years? Right, millions of Christians around our country have left their communities, right, have severed relationships, have slowed the advance of the gospel and the kingdom in their cities because of an utter unwillingness to even be the slightest bit inconvenienced or uncomfortable in the need of meeting the needs of another person. But guess what? Jesus had rights too. Often that was done in the name of my rights, right? And Jesus had rights that he didn't have to let go, but he didn't grasp for them. He gave up his divine rights, his divine privilege, and he came into this world. But then Paul goes on to say, he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, right? He didn't just come to earth as a king. He could have, right? Even condescending from the heavens down into the form of a man would have been enough. And he could have come as a king and said, bow down at my feet, worship me, I'm here, bow down. But he didn't come as a king. He came as a servant. He bowed down to wash our feet. Right? Jesus always had time for people. Right? He always had time for the people that nobody had time for. Right? He said, let the children come to me. Right? The poor and the lame and the blind, the people that his disciples said, go away. Jesus is really important. He doesn't have time for you. He had time for those people. He ate with tax collectors and sinners, the outcasts of society. He said, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Right? Take my yoke upon you. I am gentle and I am lowly. That's the same word for humble that Paul uses here. I'm lowly in spirit. He didn't just lower himself from the heavens to the earth. He lowered himself from the position of a king to the position of a servant. But then he went further, because Paul says he humbled himself by becoming even obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Like there's no lower place that our Lord and Savior could have taken. Right? He left the heights of heavens and he went lower and lower and lower and lower until he went to the cross. In verse 3, we skip this, but Paul says, count others as more important than you. And that word count there, it means to treat someone as if they were more worthy than they actually are. And you look at that and you say, man, I can't do that. How do you do that? Well, the way you do that is you look at Jesus, because Jesus did that for us. Right? He counted us to be worthy of this humbling, even though we were not worthy. And on the cross, he was emptied to the uttermost, right? He was poured out. He wasn't emptied of his divinity. Just to be clear, Jesus never ceased to be fully God and fully man. He never has. He never will cease. He was not emptied of his godly, of his godness. He was emptied of his reputation, right? He was emptied of what you might call his glory, right? The guards mocked him. The crowds condemned him. He was emptied of his glory so that you and me, with our glory empty souls, could be filled up. I remember that word conceit. It means empty glory. Same word for empty as Paul uses here when it says that Jesus emptied himself. Jesus emptied himself of his reputation. He emptied himself of his glory so that our insecure hearts could be filled. Right, Jesus' heart was poured out so that we could have the love of the Father poured into our hearts. I remember the opposite of humility is a person who says, look at me. Right, look at me because I'm empty of glory. I don't know if I matter. I don't know if I have value, if I have significance. That's the opposite of humility. But when you realize, the more we realize that the most glorious set of eyes in the universe have already looked at you in Jesus and said, you are loved, you are valuable, and look what I did to prove that to you and to make that possible. When you realize that, it begins to fill up that void that is in each of our hearts. Right on the cross, Jesus bore the consequences of our rebellion. He bore the weight of our wrongdoing, of our sin. And the Father looked at the Son and looked away. Right? Jesus said, why have you forsaken me, God? The Father looked away from his Son so that he could look at you and say, you're my beloved Son. You are my beloved daughter. In you, I am well pleased. And that's freedom, church. That is freedom. That begins to free you from the need to move in the world to use people or to have people look at you to let you know that you are okay, because God has already said you are okay. Right? That frees you to look out for the interest of others. Look at our Savior, church. He couldn't have gone any lower. from the height of heaven to the earth, to the station of a servant, to the cross, to the grave. Jesus went down, and then he went down some more, and then he went down some more, and then Christ, and then God the Father raised him up. That's how the hymn ends. The hymn ends. And one of the objections that I think I feel whenever I hear this is, okay, I want to be humble. I want to serve the needs of other people, but what if what? They take advantage of me, right? That's the first thing we think, and that's fair. But Jesus was lowered, and God raised him back up, exalted him back up to the heavenlies. And there is some comfort in knowing that if we are in Christ, if we are connected with him now, as we lay our lives down, the Father will lift us up with Christ and give us what we need. Now, if when you hear any of that, right, that short little reflection on Paul's him here, if when you hear that, there's even a small part of you, which hopefully there is, if there's a small part of you that says, wow, that's amazing. Look at Jesus. Look at what he has done for you, what he's done for me. But if there's a small part of you that does that, you know what's happening? That's humility beginning to grow. As you walk, as you look away from you, and you look at something that's bigger and better than yourself. The key to unity is humility. And the key to humility is looking away from me and more towards Jesus. Not as a one-time thing that we do in church, but as the movement of our life away from self into the glory of Christ. That is what frees us to put the needs of others above our own. The band's going to come up now and lead us, prepare to lead us in a final song here. But as they do, I want you to know, I am far from this, right? It's a weird thing to come up as a not super humble person and preach about humility, right? We are all in process. But my prayer for me, my prayer for you, my prayer for our whole church is that as we become more and more saturated in the gospel, we will be freed to love each other and drive unity, because that is what the world needs right now, church. Right, the world needs to see a community of people who are not carbon copies of each other, but are really different and yet are unified, have one heart, one mind, and stand side to side for the advance of the gospel. They need to see that in this church. They need to see that in our friendships, in our marriages, in our relationships with coworkers, especially with other brothers and sisters in Christ. So here's what we're going to do. I want to take the next couple of minutes, 1-2 minutes, just to give us some time to reflect before the ushers come down. Ushers, you can come down whenever the worship band begins to sing and pass out the elements, because we are going to take communion together like we do every week. But I want us to just sit in prayer as the band plays and reflect on what Jesus did for us, how he lowered himself for us, and then maybe ask the question, Lord, where are you calling me to put the interest of someone else above my own? And look at Christ, and then ask, where are you calling me to put the interest of somebody else above my own for the sake of the gospel? So take a couple minutes to do that, and then we will sing a song. Thank you.
this darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord.
Church, we're not trying to rush you. If you want to just sit with the Lord for a little bit longer, feel free. If you want to stand and sing, feel free. Mostly just feel free in this space. On to talk about how someday all the earth will shout his praise. All the earth will shout his praise. And that's something that we can look forward to, that we can rejoice in. And so I think if you are ready to go ahead and stand up with us, this is a really good time to do it as we sing about how someday all the earth will shout his praise. Our hearts will cry and these bones will sing, great are you, Lord.
Are going to be passed out. But what an amazing opportunity for us as we consider the humility of Jesus Christ and what Pastor Reese just preached, that we get to remember that Jesus humbled himself to the point of the grave. where the Father looked away from the Son so that the Son can look to us. And so today, as the elements are being passed out, my encouragement for all of us is to consider and remember all that the Lord has done for us, for you. I think this is a great opportunity for us to even consider our running away from the Lord and how Jesus, in his humility, going to the cross, essentially what Jesus is doing is running to us. So the Bible reminds us, even in what was just preached this morning, that Jesus Christ humbled himself to the point of death, and not just death, but a humiliating death. Jesus did that for you and for me, so that we may be able to be free and freed up into a right relationship with God. And so, friends, if you are a believer, a follower of Jesus Christ, then we invite you to take communion with us this morning. If you've put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ, then there's an opportunity to rejoice in the goodness of God and what God has done for us. So the Bible reminds us that on the night that Jesus Christ was arrested and betrayed, that he broke bread with his disciples as he was preparing for what he knew was to come. Jesus broke bread and he said, "This is my body broken for you." And so, church, today we remember the broken body of Jesus. Church, he also took the cup and he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant." Meaning that now God's grace is absolutely sufficient because King Jesus humbled himself and he rose triumphantly from the grave. What does that mean for us today? As we prepare to drink this juice, we are remembering that the blood of Jesus ushered us into the covenant of God's grace. And that means we are forgiven, period. Forgiven. God's grace is sufficient for you today. Walk in the freedom of forgiveness because of God's grace. Today we drink. Amen. In church every week, we like to continue in worship where we consider even our giving as worship to the Lord, where we get to further the mission of God in our generosity as believers in Jesus Christ. And so we're going to pass the buckets around. If you are new here, then we just want to invite you to just don't feel like you need to put anything in these buckets. Our hope is to let this serve as a reminder to what we get to do and what we get to give and what we get to partake in as we are generous as believers. And so, church, I want to pray for us. So let us bow in a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much. Lord, we thank you for a time to remember the broken body and the shed blood of Jesus. God, thank you that today we are reminded through your word of the humility of Jesus Christ. God, how you love us, how you're for us, how you desire to free us not only from sin, you want to free us from ourselves, that we might look to others. And so, Lord, as we prepare our hearts for more singing, we pray that you would just free our lips to sing for you, to make much of you. It's in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Not by might, not by power, by your Spirit, God. Your Spirit, God, not by might, not by power, by your Spirit, God, send your Spirit, not by God, not by might, not by power, by your Spirit, God, send your Spirit, God, not by might, not by power.
His faithfulness is to us, Lord. Let's, God, thank you that you have been so good, that you have been so faithful to us. And I think that just a right response as we think about unity, as we think about humility, is just to look at you and to see the things that you have done in our lives. As Pastor Reese mentioned, you didn't have to come and save us, but you chose to. You chose to humble yourself. And you are great, and worship is a right response. So let's sing, Great is Your Faithfulness.
Great is Your faithfulness to me. Great is Your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise Your name. Great is Your faithfulness to me.
God of Abraham. Keep the mic on his desk.
God of Abraham, You're the God of covenant, of
faithful promises. Time and time again, You have proven do just what You say.
Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn. When You speak a word, it will come to pass.
Sing it out. Great is Your faithfulness to me. Great is Your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise Your name. Great is Your faithfulness to me.
Father, thank You that You meet us where we are. God, that You have given us a way to pursue unity in a time when it's really confusing how to do that. Father, You've given us Your Son, and that is, the easy answer to everything is to fix our eyes on You. Because when we look at You, we become small. Others become greater. And Father, it's simple. It's not a lot of work just to fix our eyes on Jesus, because You're everywhere. Help us to see You this week and help us to see others. Amen.
Hey, church, as we prepare to end our time this morning, one announcement that we want to share is every last Sunday of the month, we do Newcomers Connect. So if you are new here and you are looking to find out information about how to get plugged in, questions about Christ Freedom Church, mission groups, how to serve community, any of those questions will be covered at Newcomers Connect next week. We have it here about an hour before service starts. And so we will love to have you guys to join us at 9 o'clock to hear more about Christ Freedom Church and how to get plugged in and connected. Thank y'all so much for joining us for this Sunday gathering. We're going to sing our benediction and be dismissed.
Holy, 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 merciful and mighty God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
God bless you, church.
Listen, Eden is kingdom, and Eden mindset is a kingdom mindset. Let me hear ya. Where my Eden citizens at? Where my Eden citizens at? Where you at? Let me see you, do you